No other place has held out so much hope to so many, or spawned such mythic tales of heroism. No other country has been so defined by its belief that anyone can reach unattainable heights with nothing more than sheer will, hard work, and a bit of luck. In the middle of the 20th century, with their country in crisis, Americans found that hero among their own.
We're gonna do our part and we will win because we are on God's side.
His stage was so big that downtrodden Americans, regardless of their age or race, felt a glimmer of hope creep into their lives just by watching him.
A new world champion, Joe Louis.
In the end, he was a common man who reached the top and brought an entire country with him.
My father, Joseph Louis Barrow, was born to a sharecropping family. It was Chambers County, Alabama. My grandmother was an extraordinary woman and really kept that family together because my grandfather had a mental problem and was put in an asylum very early on when my father was a baby. So he really didn't know who his father was.
This is Joe Louis. I mean, he's poor, he's black, he's one of eight children. The chances of this guy doing anything in his life is just absolutely remote.
Back in those days, black didn't have a name. He was nigger. Hey, you nigger.
Driven from the South by racial persecution, 12-year-old Joe Barrow and his family joined the Great Migration North in search of social and economic opportunity.
Well, Joe shows up in Detroit, and he's a shy kid. He has virtually no education. He starts doing jobs. I mean, he's a laborer. He'll work in Ford for a while, but before that, he works at whatever manual job he can find. He delivers ice.
They were making ends meet. In fact, my grandmother had enough extra change to eventually give my father monies for violin lessons.
But Joe needed a manlier hobby. So said his friend, Thurston McKinney.
So Thurston told him, man, you ain't a sissy. Ain't no but sissy to play. Play the violin, so why don't you come down to the gym and learn how to box?
He used a quarter that my grandmother was giving him for violin lessons week after week to rent this locker Brewster Gymnasium. Eventually, the violin instructor comes back to the house and says to my grandmother, where's my student Joe? And she says, what do you mean, where's your student Joe? And as I like to affectionately say, he had a little come to Jesus with him because she wanted to know where that quarter was going and he was wasting it. Eventually, she understood that he liked boxing and simply said, you know, if you're gonna do this, be the very best that you can.
You could see he was just trying to learn. They'd tie his hands behind his back and all he had to do was use the left hand. So you gotta learn how to use that hand good.
He's quickly matched in an amateur fight, his first fight, and Joe Louis gets beaten up pretty badly.
And he got knocked down seven times, but he kept getting up. So when Thurston had him in the dressing room, he said, Joe, you was going up just like an elevator, up and down.
People don't realize how many times he fought as an amateur. He fought over 50 times, won a gold glove, and found that area of competence that all kids are looking for. And boxing was that for Joe Louis.
Dropping his last name, Barrow, the newly named Joe Louis found a manager in Detroit numbers racketeer John Roxborough. One look at Louis's right fist convinced Roxborough he was making a sound investment. He signed Louis to a contract and partnered with Chicago numbers man Julian Black. They then hired boxing veteran Jack Blackburn to nurture their investment.
Jack Blackburn, quite frankly, comes with some baggage. He's an alcoholic. He's a very bitter man. He had done some jail time for a murder, but he knows boxing. This guy is as good as they get.
Jack Blackburn says, sure, you bring that white boy around, I'll take a look at him. And they break the news to Jack that this guy's black. And he said, I don't want to train a black fighter. And the reasoning being is, there's nothing I can do with him that will be successful.
After Jack Johnson, there is no way a black fighter is going to rise to the top of the heap. He can't become champion.
But because he needed the money, it was steady income, Black Bear took the job. He sat down, he told Cholos, listen, you're gonna have to be twice as good as the white fighter that you're fighting in order to succeed.
Jack Johnson, America's first black heavyweight champion, inspired so much hatred in white America that in the 19 years since the end of his reign, no black fighter was given the opportunity to even challenge for the heavyweight crown.
I think Jack Johnson saw his job in life as pissing off white America. He married white women, he flaunted his wealth, he gloated over fallen opponents, he had those gold teeth, and he flashed that smile.
White Americans generally reacted to Johnson's heavyweight reign as this is proof of the danger in letting a black man have a real opportunity.
When Joe Louis came along, the people in the fight world were mindful of the fact that they didn't want a repetition of Jack Johnson.
They made up a set of rules and they handed them to Louis and said, you need to follow these rules at all times. And these rules were set up to make him appear to be the complete opposite of Jack Johnson.
For example, Louis was never to have his picture taken alone with a white woman.
We want you to be humble at all times.
If you knock a white man out and you raise your hand, it could start a riot.
He was never to be seen smiling or gloating over opponents.
Joe Louis then, in every way, was being trained to act white.
My name is Joe Louis, 20 years old, 6 feet one, 195 pounds, going to win 10 fights from this ring.
Louis turned pro in 1934 and won his first 12 fights, 10 by knockout. It was a welcome sight and a symbol of hope to blacks suffering through the Depression.
There is nobody like him on the scene. If you go to the average black newspaper from about 1935 on, there is not a issue that goes by that Joe Louis isn't in there. Joe Louis is eating a meal, Joe Louis is training, Joe Louis is out on a date, Joe Louis is in there for something, but Joe Louis is in there because Joe Louis's picture sells papers to black people.
By the middle of 35, Louis had won 22 fights without a loss. Given the realities of the day, a black fighter, even one as promising as Louis, had little chance of going anywhere.
Now can his management get him into the big time? The big time's New York. Jimmy Johnston is running Madison Square Garden at this time. Roxborough calls him up. Do you want Louis? Johnston says, we don't need him.
But Roxborough and Black found an ambitious promoter wasn't about to let race keep him from a possible fortune.
Mike Jacobs grew up poor in New York City, and Jacobs wanted to break Madison Square Garden's monopoly on title boxing. And he wasn't afraid of signing a black fighter.
1935, Jacobs signs Louis up. He's bringing him to New York. Louis gets off at the train station. Porters carrying Louis off on his shoulders. Joe Louis is a hero, a savior for them. And as far as Mike Jacobs is concerned, a savior for boxing. His scheme was to match Joe Louis up with a string of ex-champions.
Y'all heard about Primo Canary. They thought he was so good. But Joe started...
6 feet, 6 and a half. He weighed 265 pounds. He was a giant.
Primo Carnero was one of those sideshow attractions that made it in boxing. This guy is big and strong and scary looking. Louis is faster. Louis hits harder.
We're in perfect condition for Primo Canary, and I'll win from him because he is big and easy to hit.
Then Joe walked up to the main mountain and kindly shook his hand. Then Joe backed up a step or two and knocked him in the promised land. So knock it, Joe.
Here's this black man who's coming out and ascending, and it just gave tremendous, tremendous energy to black America.
I didn't know any blacks that I could be proud of because of what they had accomplished, except the school teachers, the Undertaker. the reverence. But as a kid, Joe Louis was everything. He just was the epitome of racial pride. Racial pride.
But the affection that Louis engendered in the black community didn't spread much beyond it.
When Joe Louis knocked out Primo Carnera, big article entitled, Joe Louis Must Never Be Champion. Mainly it was all kind of riots. It would disturb the structure in the United States. Can you imagine that? Why Joe Louis must never be champion.
Well, Joe, I see you're back at your old camp, and you're going to train in private. What's the idea in that?
Well, I feel much better training in private.
Some in the white sporting press began to take note of Louis's accomplishments, though they still viewed him first as a black man, then as a boxer.
Virtually every sentence written about Joe Louis would refer to the color of his skin. People are familiar with the alliterative nickname, the Brown Bomber. That was only one of 100 alliterative nicknames that incorporated the color of his skin. The sepia slugger, the coffee-colored clouder, the dark destroyer. It just went on and on and on. At first, he was this freak.
They tell me that Farr looks good in training. That's good, cause nothing I like better than give a fan a good fight. I hope to knock him out.
He'd freeze up. Even in his dressing room interviews, when after the fight, the reporters would come swarming around, you know, and he just couldn't handle that.
They started to describe him as a stereotypical darkie, lazy, liking watermelon and chicken, sleeps a lot. The reality is that he was one of the hardest working fighters of his day. He ran 6 miles a day. He sparred 5 times a week. He was remarkably strong. He was in great shape.
In September 1935, Louis faced the biggest test of his young career. A match against former champ Max Baer.
Max Baer stands in my way for a chance for the title, so I'm going to shoot the Wex to beat him.
Max Baer could punch good, and that was it. He couldn't box at all.
He had a hell of a right hand. I mean, he had killed a person in the ring.
Max Baer proved he could be a killer, but he had rather be a clown.
Hey, Max, how do you figure that improves your condition?
Strengthens my wrists, you know, my hands.
Uh-huh. Well, so long, champ. Don't overwork.
In many black communities across America, few events were bigger than a Joe Louis fight.
I lived in St. Louis, and you heard it through the black community that Joe Louis is fighting on such and such a night. And it was better than Christmas. Because on Christmas, you couldn't be guaranteed you was going to get anything.
The town of Stamps, Arkansas. My grandmother owned the only black-owned store in the town. And we had a radio. All the black people in the town would come around the store to listen when Joe Louis was fighting.
Everybody in Harlem was for Joe Louis. Are you gonna listen to the fight tonight? Are you gonna listen to the fight tonight? And when you opened up your window or sat on the fire escape, you had roundabout sound all over the neighborhood.
That was our day.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are about to present a ringside, blow-by-blow description of the Baer-Louis fight.
And then, 8 o'clock.
At a time when the sport of boxing, as well as the country itself, was mired in a depression, Louis was a savior. There was such a clamor to see him take on Max Baer that 95,000 fans crowded into Yankee Stadium in what was boxing's first million-dollar gate in nearly a decade.
We'll tell you blow by blow, they're on.
And there's the bell. And the battle is on. They come out. Max is very cautious.
You could feel hearts thumping because if Joe loses, our whole race will be down.
Each time a round was over, the explosion of sound when one man would ask, did you see that? And it was never here. As always, did you see Joe Louis? So then the radio would be turned up. Silence.
And he took a natural right and then a left of the jaw, and he has gone to his knees. Your fight is all over.
And then after it was over, the doors opened and everybody rushed to the streets.
And what I heard was an explosion. When these doors flew open and black people just ran out into the area, little babies not knowing why their mother was jumping up and down and hugging them. I mean, they had this release.
What he represented was, if you give us an equal playing field, and if you allow us to compete, we can compete. Just give us the chance. Don't hold us down, just give us the chance.
On that same September day, Lewis made not only the back page, but the front page as well.
Do you intend to be the boss at home too, Joe?
I'm the boss home too.
It broke the hearts of half of the women in the United States of America of color. Because everyone wanted to marry Joe Lewis.
He fell in love with Marva Trotta, a young woman who worked at the Chicago Defender, an African-American newspaper. She was marrying the most important black man in America. And so this image of African-American domestic bliss was part of selling Joe Lewis to white America.
How about a nice big kiss and finish it?
Yeah. That won't happen.
By the mid-30s, Lewis was not only famous, but rich beyond anyone's dreams. In 35 alone, when the average American was making less than $1,400 a year, the 21-year-old Lewis earned $400,000 in purses.
Money meant nothing to Joe. He hit the number in New York. It was like $8,000. And they paid him off in mid-afternoon. When Joe got back to the Teresa Hotel, he didn't have $100.
He'd be giving this guy $5, this guy $10, this guy $100 like that. He was giving $100 just like he, no.
And remember, he came from a family that had to share to survive. So when he had money, he shared his money. Many people criticized him and probably said he was generous to a fault.
There was your public Joe Lewis and there was your private Joe Lewis. The public Joe Lewis was the opposite of Jack Johnson. Privately, however, there were some things there that were very similar to Jack Johnson.
It's amazing how many women he was able to have relationships with. Chorus girls were like leeches. Joe walked in the room and they were just hanging, clinging to him.
He was colorblind with women. Sonya Hay, Lana Turner.
Lena Horne was another that he had a relationship with. And that was tough for my mother.
God, that woman put up with so much. Some of the women were, they would walk right past her to get to Joe, ignore her completely, show her no respect.
But I remember one time my mother asked my father to go out to get a loaf of bread, and he went out to the store, and he didn't come back for 2 weeks or so. Well, my father did return with the loaf of bread and a diamond ring. I remember seeing that ring, and I said, how'd you get that ring? Your father gave it to me, and that was it.
After spending 3 months away from the ring, a refreshed Lewis aimed his sights at the heavyweight crown, then held by James Braddock. But to get a shot at Braddock, he'd have to stay unbeaten.
Das Herz eines Boxers kennt nur eine Liebe, den Kampf den Sieg ganz allein.
Early summer of 1936, Lewis matched against another ex-champion, Max Schmeling, from Germany. Adolf Hitler came to power January 1933. For most of America, Hitler's an eccentric, but is he a real threat? No, he's more of a comedic figure. He's more of a great dictator, Charlie Chaplin figure.
Say, Joe, what do you think of this fellow Schmeling?
Well, Jack, you know he's a tough man, but you can bet that thing that it won't go 15 rounds.
Joe Lewis had weaknesses. He started to believe his own press clippings. Wasn't training, was doing a little more golfing.
Ed Sullivan introduced my father to golf. Well, in 36, instead of preparing for Max Schmeling, he was spending more time on the golf course.
Not only did the overconfident Lewis undertrain, but he violated the sport's unwritten rule about abstinence.
He was in the Norwood Hotel. A chorus girl had a room there that he was seeing, and I heard that he was there. I said, but he's in training, he can't be there. I went up the fire escape and looked in the room, and I saw him. There he sat on the bed, and they were laughing. and I went through the door and I knocked down the door. He jumped up and I chased him out of the hotel and he got in the car and they went back to camp. There was a period when he was out of control.
Say, Max, from watching Joe Louis in action and in pictures, have you detected any particular weakness in the Brown Bomber?
Yes, I did, but I won't tell.
Whenever somebody asked him, what gives you the belief that you can beat Joe Louis, the answer was always the same. He told everybody, I saw something.
What he saw was that when Louis threw his jab, he brought it back low. So what Schmeling felt is, if I can get close enough, if I can time it, if I can withstand a couple jabs to my face, I'm going to get my shot.
And Schmeling over a right hand high on Louis' jaw that made Louis rock his head. Schmeling has sent Louis down. Joe Louis is down.
His mom couldn't take the beating. And my husband, Fred, had to take her home because she was just getting all hysterical. He was just getting a good whipping. Yeah.
Then Donovan broke them. Schmeling got over two more hard strikes to Louis' jaw.
You could see strange look on people's face. Sadness.
And made Louis give down, and there Schmeling straightened up Louis with hard rights and left of the jaw.
It was our own race going down.
He has stuffed up Louis' left cheek, and Louis is down. Louis is down, hanging to the rest, hanging back. He is a very tired fighter.
Oh, God, let him get up. Oh, God. Please, don't let him hurt him.
He is blinking his eyes, shaking his head. The count is done. The fight is over. The fight is over. And Schmeling is the winner. Lewis is completely out. They have to lift him and carry him to his corner.
72 right hand. 72 right hands. He went for 12 rounds. He couldn't take it no longer.
He let us all down. There was no doubt about it.
Here was the guy who was the race hero. Here was the guy who represented the best hopes and aspirations and virtues of the race, and he lost.
As for Schmeling, he went home to Germany, the idol of a nation.
After the first fight, he was a hero, for sure, because nobody, especially in Germany, really believes that he can beat Joe Louis. He was the best ambassador for this horrible government.
Louis, on the other hand, now had to face his public failure.
Joe was devastated. He was devastated.
And my mother tells me stories of how literally he would walk in Harlem with a very down head, and little black boys would walk up to him and whisper in his ear, Max Schmeling. Max Schmeling.
The loss was a major setback to Louis's challenge for the title. It was now Schmeling and not Louis who got a shot at Braddock.
Well, I'm very happy to fight for the heavyweight championship again. And especially, I'm glad to fight Jimmy Braddock.
Wer sie vergewaltigt hat, hat uns vergewaltigt!
But capitalizing on growing anti-German sentiment in America, Louis's promoter Mike Jacobs induced Braddock to call off the fight with Schmeling and give the match to Louis instead.
Jacobs starts to work his sleight of hand, and he's going to Braddock and he's saying, Braddock, look, you're going to get a piece of Louis.
The backroom deal paid Braddock handsomely. Over the next 10 years, he received 10% of Jacobs's net profits from all of Louis's title fights. No one knows how much of Louis's cut was sacrificed in the process, but whatever the cost, Louis was now in line for the title.
War is formally declared in Chicago between Jimmy Braddock on the left, world heavyweight champion, and Louis the Brown Bomber.
With the tacit approval of much of white America, a black man, for the first time in 29 years, was challenging for the heavyweight crown. For black America, it was a milestone moment, and Joe Louis was at the center of it.
And now, here in Chicago, the heavyweight boxing title is at stake. Will Joe Louis walk out of the ring as heavyweight champion of the world? We'll soon know.
The excitement raced through the 60,000 fans at Comiskey Park. No one could wait to see who would land the first blow.
Now at close quarters, Lewis is racing hard. And Lewis took the fall. He went down, but didn't stay down.
So he comes out early in the fight and he drops Lewis. And Lewis wasn't hurt, you know. In fact, he popped right back up. Jack Blackburn quipped, you know, you're not going to fool the whole stadium into thinking you didn't just get knocked down. Stay down, take your aid count.
Lewis stepping out fast, evidently going to carry the pace of Braddock, taking a chance on youth against age.
Slowly the fight turned, and literally, like most guys, he just battered Braddock down.
Now Braddock moves under the ring, and Lewis sees him. Oh, Braddock is down. And the count is 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Was your champion. And papers came out an hour after Joe Lewis's fight. Tomorrow morning's paper, extra, 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 you know.
Well, Black America celebrated, and they just loved the fact that all of a sudden their champion was there.
To see the picture of this gorgeous black man and this white boy down,
it was vindication that we were the strongest people in the world. Some black mother's son, some black father's son, was the strongest man in the world.
But the unfortunate consequence is that my father had to share that title with him financially for the rest of his life.
Well, Joe, how does it feel to wake up this morning the heavyweight champion of the world?
Oh, Junior, I felt fine. I felt like I can defend the next week sometime.
Even though Lewis owned what was then the most coveted prize in sports, he couldn't completely revel in it.
When I spoke with my father about that, there is no question that he did not feel internally that he was the heavyweight champion of the world when he defeated Braddock in 1937, because he still had this cloud of Max Schmeling's defeat a year earlier over him.
In May 1938, when Schmeling arrived in New York, Lewis had gotten his wish. With Mike Jacobs backing the deal, the two fighters signed a contract for their June rematch.
Joe Lewis defends his World Heavyweight Championship against former title holder Max Schmeling, the only man who has ever defeated the champion.
Lewis's take would be $350,000. Schmeling's would be half that.
Almost immediately after the contracts were signed, this fight really turns into something political.
U.S. recognition of the evils of Nazi Germany was very slow in coming. But Hitler's ambitions were becoming more noticeable. So the symbolism of Joe Lewis fighting a representative of Nazi Germany was not lost on the American public in 1938.
It was probably the first time and the only time in the history of America that a black man ended up being a white hope. He become the great white hope.
Why should I go to the ring gun-shy when Schmeling's 2 years older and I'm 2 years smarter in boxing?
Certainly we, as a race of people, needed someone to say that we could do something that white people held on a pedestal.
White Americans accepted Joe Lewis as this sort of emblem of the United States, of emblem of American democracy.
Joe Lewis was the man.
But in 1938, Americans still did not speak with a single voice.
I hate to say it, but many of the white people in the South didn't want to see Joe Lewis win.
Well, Brooklyn, the neighborhood that I lived in was practically all Jewish, and we were all hoping and praying that Joe Lewis would kick the shit out of him.
4,000 miles away, in the clutches of Hitler's growing empire, a 16-year-old boy had similar sentiments.
As a witness to the Nazi invasion of Austria, I recall, of course, very vividly the old city decorated with Nazi flags, Nazis marching through the streets. To us, Schmeling, the representative of this Nazi Germany, was the Goliath. Joe Lewis was the David.
It was the biggest pre-fight buildup you ever heard. Thousands of people would come just to watch him spar. It was an international event.
All of the hype only made Lewis train harder and focused more.
Somebody asked him before the fight, Joe, how do you feel? Joe said, man, I'm scared. That's not what you want a boxer to say. What? I'm scared I'm going to kill him.
He had more pressure than any fighter ever had in his life because he was scaring the country.
Ordinarily, a summer night in Harlem would have brought residents out on their stoops hoping for a cool breeze. But on June 22, 1938, every stoop in Harlem was empty.
The streets were eerily quiet, no cars. It was like a scene after the atom bomb, you know. And this was duplicated in every large city, by the way.
There's this, that one great cartoon where they show the globe sitting on a ring looking at the fight, and the entire world's focus was on this fight. That's true. This fight was the biggest fight in the history of the world.
There was a crackling atmosphere that night that's unlike anything. You know, no World Series, the seventh game of the World Series, nothing compared to that, the electricity in the air.
This is the feature attraction. 15 rounds for the world's heavyweight championship.
60 to 70 million people listened to it on the radio in America, over 100 million worldwide.
We were crowded around the radio. It was like a magical something that was happening in our house, and I still feel it today.
And there we are, and we got to the ring right together with Arthur Donovan Sipper and Grun, and Joe Louis is in the center of the ring, Max going around. Joe Louis red six with two straight left to the chin.
There was a difference in the announcer's voice. That night it sounded like they loved him. It sounded like he wasn't a nigger to them. Joe had become an American.
Inside Yankee Stadium, a cloud of expectation hung over the crowd of 80,000.
And Louis hooks the left to Max's head quickly, and jumps over a hard right to Max's head. Louis, a left to Max's jaw, a right to his head. Max shoots a hard right to Louis. Louis for the old 1-2.
I'm in the second row. I could see their facial expressions. And Schmeling was in fear right from the beginning. He realized that this is something else, a different cut of cat than I had 2 years ago.
Lewis out, and Lewis missed with a left wing body and close front of a hard right to the jaw. And again, a right to the body.
And Schmeling let out a piercing scream. Nobody had ever heard that from a ring. It was reported like the scream of a woman, which isn't very nice about women.
We could see that he was about to fall. You know, the crowd is just jumping up, pushing him. Joe, 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 Joe.
Schmeling is down. And he's up, and Louis, right and left to the head, a left to the jaw, a right to the head. And Donovan is watching carefully. Louis measured him, right to the body, a left up to the jaw, and Schmeling is down.
The house just went crazy. You couldn't hear nothing. And Joe stood there like, what the hell happened?
Max Schmeling, he never thought that the fight will ending in this way and so fast. Absolutely no. He was the loneliest man on earth in this moment.
That was the happiest moment in America when Schmeling could not get on his feet.
I was 14 years old, and our family had the only radio in the area. Some of our African-American neighbors came and asked my father if they could come and listen to the fight. So Daddy thought there would be three or four of them, but when the time for the fight came, I would guess there were 40 showed up. It was very interesting because the customs of the South then prevailed, and there was not a sound out of the black listeners. Nothing. It's absolute quiet after Lewis won. And then they walked across the railroad a couple hundred yards away, and all hell broke loose. They celebrated all night long until early, almost daylight.
It was phenomenal to be black. because Joe Louis was a hero of all the people, but he was black like me. That was a defining moment in black history.
It made us feel that as the superhero of the Nazis was overcome, so in time, the brutal regime of the Nazis would also be overcome.
He sent a signal to the world that there's no such thing as this white Aryan race. And all of a sudden, Joe Louis transcended from a heavyweight champion to a true American hero.
Now let us talk about the brown bomber. Tell the nation the story. Let us talk about the brown bomber.
And at the end, indescribable scenes. People were hugging each other all around the stadium. And some people began to shout, "Back to Hitler, you bum." It's just wild. I've never seen anything like it before or since.
People happy and joyous because you had one common denominator. He won. He won. And when he won, you won.
In Detroit, in his hometown, he was theirs. He got rolls of toilet paper and went through the neighborhood throwing the toilet paper out, screaming, "He won! He won!" Just plain joy.
Black people were crazy. All those people I love, crying, laughing, hollering, screaming, running, jumping. It was the most uniting force I've ever seen in my life. There's something here. There's some magic here. What is that magic, and how can I get it?
When we left Yankee Stadium, you had to walk so far because of the traffic, the people. It was a party, and it started in Harlem, under 25th and 7th Avenue.
I was in a car. Inadvertently, I got off at the wrong road and got into Harlem. People were dancing and singing, and of course they were drinking too. And I had to stop at a light, and a big black guy stuck his hand through the window, grabbed me at the throat, and said to me, "Are you Schmeling, man?" I said, "No, I'm all the way for Joe Louis." "Okay, go ahead."
I've interviewed people, and they've told me, you know, white Americans saying, you know, Joe Louis was the first black American that I felt something for, that gave me a warm feeling, that I cared about. And that's the role Joe Louis played.
Let us talk about the brown bomber. Joe Louis was a fighting man.
In the aftermath of the fight, Schmeling was a disgraced man in the eyes of Germany. No longer the darling of the Third Reich, he was shipped off to the front lines as a paratrooper.
He wasn't anymore at all a hero. He was a loser. Hitler couldn't use a loser, especially against a black man.
Across the ocean, Louis was on top of the world. He was perhaps the most recognizable man in America, and he had godlike invincibility in the ring.
In a backward position, all right, George Duff takes that flat on his back. Please.
I think he's the best heavyweight of all time. I think Ali would have given him a hell of a fight, but Ali couldn't hit quite as hard. I think Louis at his prime would have knocked Dempsey out without question. He was a remarkable fighter.
Since becoming champ in 37, Louis had successfully defended his title 18 straight times. He'd made victims of such undistinguished contenders as Arturo the Bomber Godoy, Jack I Zigged When I Should Have Zagged Roper, and two-ton Tony Galento.
Two fighters. Joe with a vicious left this time to the side of Galeno's head. He measures his man for the kill, but Galeno goes back up against the ropes. Galeno is staggering. He goes over against the ropes. He's down on his knees. Galeno is down.
The sports writers of the day mockingly nicknamed Louis's opponents the Bum of the Month Club.
Louis fought everyone who was out there. It's not Louis's fault that he was so much better than they were, but he was a real fighting champion.
I wanted to see Joe Louis fight more than anything in the world, but I'm working at this joint and I'm making 125 a week. And I'm gonna take 75 of that for a ringside seat. I get the ticket in my hand, and I'm walking in Yankee Stadium, and I have to get to my seat for the bell. I hear the bell, and I hear ruffling and scuffling. "Go get him, Joe! It's fight is ready." And
He's down! What's down? There can be no down. I'm still walking. How do you have a person down while I'm walking? I'm holding my ticket stub. $75. Jesus Christ, could have heard it on the radio.
In 1 7-month stretch, he fought 7 times. No one benefited more than his handlers.
I think Mike Jacobs could see the war on the horizon. And I think Jacobs wanted to make as much money from Joe Louis as possible. One of the bums of the month, who wasn't a bum, was the great Pittsburgh fighter Billy Conn.
Well, I feel fine. I expect it to be a great fight.
Conn was a 175-pound light heavyweight champion, moving up to challenge the unbeatable heavyweight champion. Nobody thought he could win. Maybe his mother.
He had figured out a way to outbox Louis, which he did. You know, he kind of led Louis around the ring. It was almost like a bull in the matador.
After 12 rounds, Conn was on the verge of dethroning the champ. He had followed his plan to hit and run. But Louis was about to make good on his once famous prediction that Conn could run, but he couldn't hide.
Louis, he saw his opening, he got it, he finished Conn off, and Conn's defeated. Conn later said to Louis, said, Joe, you know, why didn't you just let me beat you? And then, you know, we would have fought 6 months later and you could have won the title back. And Louis said, he couldn't keep the title for 13 rounds. What makes you think he could have kept it for 6 months?
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin. The White House has just announced that the Japanese are attacking military and naval establishments on the island of Oahu.
Louis's first sense is, how can I help my country? And what he decides is to fight 2 fights and donate his entire purse, you know, for the 2 fights, over $100,000, to relief funds.
Well, I'm not waiting for nothing. I'm waiting for my country. And I think that's about the greatest piece of work that anybody can do.
This is at a time where the Secretary of War, Henry Stimson, refuses to integrate the armed forces.
Nonetheless, Louis gave up 4 years of his prime, along with $100,000 purses, in exchange for a soldier's pay of $21 a month.
What's your occupation?
Fighter. And let's get at them jabs.
He enlisted January 10th, 1942. He went into the entertainment division. I mean, there wasn't any real intention of seeing him out on the front lines. He was somebody who was there for morale purposes.
One of the most famous lines, one-liners for Joe Louis, was when he was raising money for the war effort. And I think the words were, we're going to win because we're on God's side. Everyone said, no, he got it wrong. We're going to win because God's on our side.
We're going to do our part, and we will win because we are on God's side.
His PR guy felt he flubbed the line. And the next day, you know, headlines in the New York papers, and my father walks into his big PR guy and drops the papers on and says, so, got the line wrong, huh?
Louis's dedication to his country and to the cause has to be seen as ironic. I mean, because, hey, you know, they haven't done anything for him except exclude him and segregate him. He's one of the first ones in line. It's almost sad that he was that naive.
First of all, being used by the army didn't go well with blacks. And he came to grips with that, you know, that we're in a big war with Hitler. And Hitler ain't gonna fix things, you know. Joe was fully aware of the fact that he was being used, by the way. You know.
What Louis is doing is not so contradictory as it might seem. In some ways, it's really, it works in the favor of black people that he's become this image of patriotism.
The army exposed Louis to the military's double standard, and he didn't like what he saw. Soft-spoken though he was, he made his feelings known.
Suddenly, Joe Louis finds his voice. Now, he doesn't attend anti-segregation lobbies, but he communicates with Truman Gibson.
Truman Gibson was an African-American who worked in the War Department in a job called civilian aid. This was a job that was created in 1941 to help with African Americans in the service. So Joe Louis was a real inspiration for many black soldiers during the war. He was treated like a hero, like a god when he would come and these soldiers would see him and crowd around him and everything. But the other thing the soldiers did, they would complain to him about their condition, about the racist conditions.
He'd pick up the phone and said, "It's not right down here, Truman, get it fixed." And the next thing you know, that general on that base would get a phone call from Washington and whatever was wrong got fixed.
Well, I'm glad to be here and I hope everybody enjoyed this exhibition and I hope to put on more in the Army camps.
Lewis visited bases around the world, happily staging exhibitions, as long as the gates were open to all troops.
There were stories out there that they were not going to let the black servicemen come to the exhibitions. He said, "I'm not going to sit here and entertain only the white troops when we've got a bunch of black troops who want to be entertained."
By the end of the war, Joe Lewis had visited more than 5 million servicemen.
General Eisenhower informs me that the forces of Germany have surrendered to the United Nations.
Americans celebrated the end of the war and then went back to civilian life. For Lewis, the transition was especially difficult. Gone were his boxing confidants. Trainer Jack Blackburn had died of a heart attack. Manager John Roxborough was sent to prison on gambling charges. The life Lewis had led before the war was gone forever.
World War II did several things to Joe's career, and nearly all of them were not good. Joe Lewis's financial state is horrible.
There's no question that when my father was in the war, he continued to spend at the same rate that he did when he was fighting.
He owes $250,000 to Mike Jacobs because he's been borrowing from Mike Jacobs all during the war because he can't fight.
So while white America was treated to this public image of Joe Lewis as a happily married man who was saving his money and who was wealthy, the reality was that he was spending it on things like bus tours for its softball team, supporting friends, family, women, everywhere. He just spent money like water.
Once the war ended, Lewis had outlived his usefulness to the country. In an act of cruel irony, the very government that had made him a symbol of American democracy now hounded him for tens of thousands of dollars in back taxes. The only thing more regrettable than Lewis's naivete was the bad advice he'd received.
He would buy tons of tickets for servicemen to attend his exhibitions, and his accountants would deduct that. The IRS wouldn't allow that, and they ran the meter while they were negotiating, and my father had this huge tax debt when he was trying to do a legitimate wonderful thing for the servicemen in this country.
He thought that he could come out of World War II and resume his ordinary lifestyle and things would be fine. The reality was, the minute he got out of the Army, he was done financially.
By his own calculations, Lewis was in debt to the government for close to $100,000. His marriage to Marva Trotter was also in ruins. And after the birth of their daughter, Jackie, in 1943, and their son, Joe Jr., 4 years later, they split up for good.
My parents were divorced when I was quite young, so I really didn't understand who Joe Lewis was. What was very frustrating is that when Daddy Joe came back and he would take us out to lunch or dinner in a public setting, how we lost our private moment with Joe Lewis. And here we are, two little kids, trying to be with the champ, and we had no privacy. And it was very disconcerting for us as young kids, and probably a little disconcerting now.
And Billy Kahn meet in the office of New York boxing commissioner Eddie Egan to sign for their world heavyweight title fight.
His battle with the IRS heating up, Lewis emerged from World War II still the heavyweight champion. In his first post-war defense, he knocked out Billy Kahn in a celebrated rematch.
And Kahn is staggered by a right to the jaw and a left hook to the chin, and Kahn is down on his back.
The fight earned Lewis his biggest payday, $625,000. But after paying off old debts, he was left with less than $100,000, before taxes. He was in a terrible bind. He couldn't retire, and he couldn't pay back the government, which was now taxing his income at 90%.
How long do you plan to continue fighting, Joe?
Well, I don't know. Last night I felt just as sharp as ever, and I'll be fighting for a long time.
Lewis down from a right to the jaw. Lewis is down from another right.
Lewis won his next three defenses. including a controversial decision over Jersey Joe Wolcott.
The winner by majority vote and still the heavyweight champion of the world, Joe Lewis.
Lewis knocked out Wolcott in the rematch and then called it quits.
Well, I'd like to say again that I retired. Tonight was my last fight. And thank you very much.
But Lewis couldn't stay away. And a year and a half later, he was back in the ring. With money where he's looming, he needed to keep fighting. In 1950, having relinquished his title by retiring, he fought Ezzard Charles. And for the first time in 13 years, entered a boxing ring as a challenger.
It's a different Joe Lewis, missing three blows in a row.
In being outpointed by Charles, Lewis lost his first fight in 14 years.
At 36, attempting a comeback after retiring, Joe Lewis finally bows in defeat.
After the loss to Charles, Lewis could no longer count on big paydays. And so, with his debt to the IRS at $500,000, he took on a succession of journeymen, getting fights wherever he could.
Now he's fighting in a little smoky arena against somebody he would have knocked out in two rounds and for comparative peanuts. How do you come to grips with that, you know?
I absolutely hated seeing him have to fight on his reputation. This man who had done so much for me spiritually, give me confidence and hope. It was not a good time for me in watching Joe Lewis.
In 1951, after exhausting himself with seven fights in 8 months, Lewis accepted an offer of $132,000 to fight rising heavyweight Rocky Marciano.
I remember specifically talking to my father when he came to Chicago, and I said, "Why are you fighting again?" He says, "I have to." I said, "Well, is it your last fight?" He says, "Yes, it's my last fight."
By all rights, Lewis had earned his retirement. His championship reign had been remarkable. He'd held the title for 11 years and 10 months and made 25 successful defenses, a record unlikely to ever fall. He'd made $5 million in purses. And now, at 37, hoped he'd have enough left to fend off his much younger opponent.
I'm in good shape for this fight, and I hope I come through all right.
Rocky was torn between fighting Joe Lewis, who was his idol, but Joe Lewis was the fight that he had to get through in order to get a match with Jersey Joe Wolcott, who was the champion.
The crowd that night was pro-Joe Lewis. You're talking about an icon, an idol. I was sitting in the audience, and here's my brother in the ring, and I felt for Joe Lewis. Rocky felt for Joe Lewis.
Lewis backing away with that wide stance again, feigning in the left hand. Marciano going into a crash. But Lewis is set up the left circle.
The first knockdown occurred with a left bang. Lewis went down.
He nails Lewis with a right to the head, a left to the body, a left to the side of Lewis.
The reaction of the crowd when Joe Lewis got knocked out, it was almost like a bit of a silence, like almost a quiet respect for the great Joe Lewis.
That was a sad night for boxing because it was the end of an era that dominated, you know, so much of American life. You know, that final moment when my father has been not only knocked down and knocked out by Marciano, but he was actually knocked through the ropes by Marciano. And you see that last sort of hanging pose of Joe Lewis, you know that it's clearly, unequivocally, the end of the Joe Lewis era.
Lewis took his final defeat in stride. He knew it was time to move on, and he did. This time to the golf course as a competitive amateur, where he soon found himself squaring off against the PGA.
In 1952, Joe Lewis and several other black players wanted to play in the San Diego Open.
The local sponsors of the San Diego Open invited the heavyweight champion of the world to play in a PGA Tour event. They didn't realize that there was a non-Caucasian rule. So my father said, "Oops, I'm gonna let them tell me to my face."
They were told by Horton Smith, who was the president of the PGA of America, that they could not play.
It's indeed unfortunate that certain misunderstandings developed in connection with the 1952 PGA co-sponsored San Diego Invitational Open Golf Tournament.
Joe Louis called Horton Smith another Hitler. He raised such a fuss about it that it caught the attention of Walter Winchell, the great American broadcaster. Because of Walter Winchell's report, a committee of the PGA of America met, and they came up with a compromise. They allowed African Americans and other minorities to qualify. So in 1952, Joe Louis became the first African American to participate in a PGA-sanctioned event. Groundbreaking, believe me, in many ways.
A few days later, Louis and seven other blacks, including golfing great Charlie Sifford, were given the opportunity to qualify for the Phoenix Open.
The first hole, Charlie Sifford went to tend the flag. He looks down in the hole, and the hole is filled with human excrement. I can't imagine what Joe Louis must have felt, being treated in such a demeaning way. Joe Louis, as far as I'm concerned, will always be remembered as a guy who opened the door and served as an example to lead others through that door.
The former heavyweight champion of the world, Joe Louis.
By the mid-50s, Louis's debt to the IRS had ballooned to $1 million.
Joe, it's getting awfully close to April 15th. You've had some income tax problems. How are you getting along?
Well, on my president's tax, I'm getting along good. So the back tax, what I'm not doing so good on.
He's got to make money without fighting.
Dance.
He's forced to really gain money through the only thing that's left, and that is his name.
Louis hawked everything from cigarettes to liquor, even his own stage show. But a natural-born salesman, he wasn't.
They come out with this Joe Louis punch. And it was like a nice punchy drink. And they were interviewing Joe, and they asked him what was his favorite drink. And he said, Coca-Cola. And they said, cut.
He had to do so many things that would have broken down anyone else. I mean, a champion of the world like him turned to wrestling.
Climbing into the ring again, Joe Louis, the former heavyweight boxing champion who'll be 42 soon, is trying the wrestling game.
It was sad. That was the only way he could generate money to pay back the government.
After 10 minutes of tugging, hauling, and poking, a right forearm smash sends Lee out of the ring.
I can't imagine in any way, shape, or form that it wasn't humiliating to him or demeaning to him. But Joe Louis did it. And he did it because he had an obligation.
It was horrible. The media crucified him.
Now, Joe, there has been quite a bit of criticism about it in the newspapers. I know that you have read it, and I'd like to know how you feel about it.
No, don't everyone agree with my idea of what I've done, but I'm sure that more people do agree with me than the ones who don't.
When I asked him once, Joe, how do you feel the way they're talking about you being a wrestler after having been such a great heavyweight champion of the world? He said, Daddy, it beats stealing.
My father was involved in a promotion of wrestling at the Olympia Stadium, the old Olympia Stadium. Joe Louis was the guest referee And I remember going in the dressing room doing the preliminaries, and my father introduced me to him. And then all of a sudden, one of the people came up from the box office and did a little whispering. And then I remember father walked up to Joe and said that the IRS had just raided the box office and they wanted your purse for back taxes. He put his head down and kind of teared up in his eyes, and he was stunned.
He wasn't running from his debt. He was just trying to deal with it in a civil fashion, in a responsible way. And they just dogged him to his forever.
Everything that Joe Louis did do during the war, all his patriotic, the things he did for his country, you know, they were not, those things were not remembered when the IRS came looking for their money.
He had set up a trust fund for my sister and for me. And the IRS came back and took the trust funds from us. I just think they wanted to rein him in and basically say, you still are under our thumb, boy.
The government had a wonderful game they were playing. Let's get Joe Louis this week. It was constant.
It's the former heavyweight champion of the world and his wife, Dennis, whose dream is to pay off a debt to Uncle Sam. From Chicago, Illinois, Mr. and Mrs. Joe Louis.
The spectacle of Louis's downfall continued. In 1956, he and his second wife, Rose Morgan, went on the TV game show High Finance and won $60,000. Louis's half went straight to the IRS.
Joe Louis, tonight, this is your life.
Hello, how are you?
I won that one on June 19, 1936, at Yankee Stadium in New York.
Yes, he's here, Joe, himself, a former world heavyweight champion from Hamburg, Germany, the back Ulan of the Rhine, Max Bailey.
The greatest tragedy is what happened to Louis and what happened to Max Schmeling. And an Atlanta-based Southern corporation, Coca-Cola, needs a distributors in post-war Germany, and Max is tapped. America will make Schmeling, a white German with ties to the Nazi Party, a millionaire. And Joe Louis, who is the symbol of democracy, will end up with nothing.
Decency, fair play, a nice person, a hell of a professional, and a guy that got screwed by the United States of America. Hey, it's Joe Louis.
In the early 60s, Louis's money troubles abated somewhat. After ending his marriage to Rose Morgan, he wed Martha Jefferson, the first black woman to practice law in California. On Louis's behalf, Jefferson made a deal with the IRS, whereby the government would not collect on the $1.3 million that Louis still owed, only on future earnings. As Louis's tax problems finally receded, so did his star power. With Muhammad Ali at the center, a new generation of black athlete was stepping into the spotlight.
In a sense, he outlived his time. To the more strident, more vocal African-American athletes of the 1960s, Joe Louis looked out of place, old-fashioned.
Cassius Clay, of course, has gotten involved somewhat in the civil rights picture, and also
he might involved in the civil rights picture because I like to think that he might involved in whatsoever in the civil rights because his thinking of civil rights is much different than thinking of the Virginia Round people who are fighting the civil rights picture. He was not a part of whatsoever.
He had trouble dealing with young black men and the way they were expressing their understandable anger at the pace of racial change in the United States.
The rage of the black man was not shared by Louis, who predated that rage and was ill-equipped to be hateful because he was of another time.
Joe Louis is making himself a Uncle Tom for white people. Negroes don't follow and idolize this part of Joe Louis.
Ali went beyond the limit of dignity in berating people. Joe Louis wasn't a showman, he was a professional. But other than that, Joe was a very quiet, soft-spoken person.
The Joe Louis that the world now knew was a far cry from the godlike figure he had been.
as Lewis went on by the late 60s, he started to change. He's smoking, he's drinking, and then eventually drugs enters into the picture, and most insidiously, cocaine.
Suddenly, the cheering stopped, and your has been. So I think that those things had a lot to do with Joe Lewis getting in with the kind of people he got in with, because underneath the world of the champion athlete, underneath it is this kind of really kind of dark sort of world of drugs and prostitution, and he kind of drifted into that.
Joe was coming up to Las Vegas, and I remember my husband Ash took a man that came up to Joe and was shoving something to him, and Joe was giving him some kind of money, and Ash took him and just threw him down the steps.
At my father's darkest moment, that he got very depressed, and a part of that depression was associated with drugs. I don't know all the details of it, other than the fact that I do know that he had some moments of paranoia.
He would take his bed and move it out to the center of the room, open up all the windows. He felt that the air vents in the hotel were maybe being poisoned.
He's afraid of things. He thinks the FBI's out to get him. He thinks the mafia's out to get him. He imagines conspiracies.
He ate nothing that didn't come out of a can or a jar. That was his fear, that somebody was gonna try to poison him. And he wasn't the Joe that I had known for 25, 35 years. He was this big, sick man.
I went to the house, and I lived in that house when I was in college, and I'd had a desk lamp. And literally, I came to see my dad, and the desk lamp was fully detached. He'd unscrewed everything, and I said, "What did you do with my desk lamp?" He says, "Well, I had to see if there were any microphones in there."
In May 1970, Joe Barra was so concerned about his father's state of mind, he arranged to have him hospitalized.
When the sheriff's department went to take him to the hospital, he said, "Why are you here?" "Well, we've got this document." He said, "Let me see this document." "Well, who's that signature?" "Well, that's your son's signature." And when he saw me later, it was basically said, "Why did you do this? Why didn't you come talk to me about it?" And I said, "Well, you need help." And it was just like, you know, this relationship that was so fragile anyway, because I didn't see him very often, was just, for me, gone forever.
Lewis spent the next 6 months in treatment. In October of 1970, he left the hospital and was recruited to Las Vegas by an old army buddy, Ash Resnick, then an executive at Caesar's Palace.
And he brought Joe here to be a guest host here at Caesar's. Why, people were dying to meet him and shake his hand, and Joe loved to do it.
When he came to Caesar's, we was working in the same pit together. He was a greeter, but he didn't do too much greeting. He would go to the crap table, you know, and people would just give him money just to gamble with him. And if he won, he kept the money.
Here he is in the casino, and he's like the manservant, the house guy, the like a doorman in a way. So he was, in his retirement period, he was not a heroic figure, in ways a pathetic figure.
Even though it was a somewhat demeaning job, I never saw that poor me scenario from him ever. And I spent a lot of time with him when he was at Caesar's.
In Las Vegas, Lewis was back in the public eye, living comfortably among friends who had helped him financially in his darkest days. To them, he was still a hero.
I mean, you can talk about him being broke, but this is a man who never had to pay for dinner in his life. He always had a roof over his head. He always had people looking after him.
We've been friends for about 35 years. And first time I ever saw him, of course, I've been cheering ever since.
None of Lewis's admirers showed greater affection for him than an old friend who years earlier had turned to Lewis for a favor.
A long time ago, when Sinatra was on stage, he had asked Joe to come on stage with him and do an act. And in fact, I think it was $10,000 that he offered to pay Joe to make the appearance. And Joe told him, "You can't pay me anything." And he made the appearance. And of course, that sealed their friendship. And like Sinatra said, it would do anything for him. Mm-hmm.
Sinatra kept his word. In 1977, when Lewis developed heart problems, Sinatra arranged to have him flown to Houston and seen by a specialist. Following heart surgery, Lewis suffered a stroke and was confined to a wheelchair.
We'd help get him in the wheelchair. We'd take him out to Caesars so he could have lunch. But the man that we knew just wasn't there anymore.
I think the pictures that some people in our society remember of Joe Lewis is when he would attend a fight in Las Vegas, and they'd go to him, and there he would be in his wheelchair with his cowboy hat. Not the lasting view you want of a Joe Lewis who had that level of impact for so many years on so many people.
On April 11th, 1981, the public got its last look at Joe Lewis.
As you look at maybe the guy who wrote the book on heavyweight boxing, and there is Joe Lewis. He is ringside attending tonight.
Later that night, Lewis's heart gave out.
I always knew that I would not be with my father when he passed. And I got this call from my roommate who basically said, they're trying to reach you from Las Vegas. Your dad has died.
Joe Lewis died today in Las Vegas. The legendary Brown Bomber, who is heavyweight boxing champ longer than any other man, was a month from his 67th birthday.
Joe Lewis will be buried Tuesday in Arlington National Cemetery. The Brown Bomber was an inspiration to millions of fans and friends.
Lewis did not qualify for burial in Arlington National Cemetery. But President Reagan waived the requirements and awarded him full military honors.
This man will be assured of a place in the hereafter because of the joy he is bringing to the multitude.
He was a champion for freedom in my mind, and he deserved to be laid to rest among champions and fighters for freedom.
He's a man that you have to say that if he hadn't lived, this century would have been different.
Lewis made white America confront race, confront success.
He made a dent. He was the one who smashed the idea that blacks weren't good enough. He began the dynamic that a generation later changed our national pastime, baseball.
I do not want to suggest that Jackie Robinson was not a national hero, but to suggest that he was the pathbreaker for black athletes is historically inaccurate. The first was Joe Lewis.
It was a wonderful spring day in Washington, D.C. The cherry blossoms were out. The playing of taps and the gun salute. It was just a recognition of who he was. And it was probably the one time that I could really say what I meant about my dad and thank him for being who he was for so many people.
The measure of a hero lies not only in their accomplishments, but also in the size of their hearts. Joe Lewis was such a hero. He loved his country and stood up for her in a time of need. He forgave her even when she betrayed him. The humblest of men, the grandson of slaves, Lewis lived the American dream and showed a nation the value of humility. By his example, he helped move America forward. And when he passed on, he left a world far better than the one he had entered.
But when he jabs with either one, that stops the fight. He's not a bad dress guy, and his hair is curled. He's the champion now of the world. He's bound to be the next champion of the world.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports.